coming to this small conference. And I'm Denis Moslanikov. This is Vicente Diaz.
Hello.
We are going to talk today about Mobile Threatscape 2012 and 2011 as well. Because 2011, from our point of view, was really like breaking year in terms of mobile malware. And well, it's a good idea to start. So first of all, some words about the statistics, what we have now, what we'll have in the future, about the Android, today is the most popular platform, the evolution of the SMS Trojans, man in the mobile or man in the middle attacks, mobile hacktivism as well, about how to protect your device, and surely in the end some forecasts. So, Vicente?
Thank you. I would like to start this talk with a small introduction. Do you know this guy, Chris Tipona? Chris Tipona is an engineer from Google, and he became famous last year when making this statement. Basically, he said, yes, various companies are playing on your fears to try to sell you protection software for Android, Rim, and iOS. They are charlatans and scammers. If you work for a company selling virus protection for Android, you should be ashamed for yourself. So, yes, we are scammers. We are charlatans.
Hello.
Hello.
We are the scammers and charlatans, yes.
So we will try to demonstrate during this presentation that at least we are trying to base our assumptions on something that is actually happening. If you are here, I don't need to tell you how important is mobile devices and the information you have there. So just to start, a quick remind of the information that you already have on your mobile phone and you maybe you don't want to share with everyone, like your contact list, in case that you use it for accessing your bank account and you have these credentials stored in your mobile device, GPS, coordinates. Well, Eugene has told you about this, so you already know. So yeah, during this presentation, we will try to demonstrate that this is something real, this is not just charlatan and the scammer scenes that we are going to show.
Well, thank you. It's very interesting, was after this quote from Chris Tipona, to hear that Google announced their own antivirus to check all the applications which will be uploaded to the Android market. So it's pretty like in the controversy. So some statistics. First of all, Eugene already showed a similar diagram. So 2011, from the very beginning till the end, we have a really exponential growth in terms of number of mobile malware per month. So from 2004, from the very beginning of the history of mobile malware till 2010, we have a really like 30, 40 new mobile malware samples per month. Now we have about 40 or 50 mobile malware samples per day. So I'm really afraid what's going to happen till the end of 2012. If we talk about platforms, as you can see, Android is a leader because Android now is one of the most popular operating systems in the world. So it's like mostly like Windows. For personal computers, we have Android for smartphones and mobile devices. So that's why cyber criminals, they have their own, let's say, main targeting platform to attack. And well, Symbian is not a leader anymore, unfortunately, or fortunately, I don't know. And well, previously, 2004, 5, 2006, 2007, Symbian was a leader. Cybercriminals were attacking mostly Symbian. Now we have Android. If we talk about behaviors, so what cybercriminals create mostly, they create mostly SMS Trojans. Applications which send SMS messages to premium rate numbers. Then goes backdoors and Trojan spies. These are also very popular among cybercriminals to steal the information and to control the device. And other behaviors like, I don't know, downloaders, some primitive Trojans which try to delete your data or something. And I pass my word to Vicente to talk about the Android.
Yeah, the good question here is, why Android is the most targeted device? Why is the most targeted operating system? So we've been thinking about this, and it's not just one reason. It's having several reasons together to explain this. The first reason is that if we take a look to the market share, all these diagrams always change. I try to get the data accurate, but you can see that at least Android seems to be gaining more market share than iOS. So from an attacker point of view, is whether to go always for the biggest market share is what happened with PCs in the past. They attacked Windows because Windows was the operating system taking the most market share in the market. So from this point of view, it makes sense. But also there is another difference. What we have seen is that the main attacking vector for these mobile devices has been putting some malicious code inside a legitimate application. After that, you put this application in the marketplace and just wait for the users to download it. They figure out it's a legitimate application, but they have this malicious code inside, so it's a Trojan. It's a very old technique. In this case, with all these application markets, it's very easy for the attacker to use this attacking vector. So the thing is that if you put this in the official Android marketplace, what happens? During last year, we saw in February, for the first time, these applications, these malicious applications, being in Google Android marketplace. As a result of that, hundreds of thousands of users were infected. And even if you have this remote wipe of the application from Google, it's not always working, because what happens is you get root access. So you own the device. Google is having no superpower here to delete this from your device. This is a problem. This happened in February. So, yeah, after 11 months in December, we find exactly the same situation again. In this case, even with more malicious applications. So after 1 year, guys, Google has not been able to solve this problem. But still, we are scammers. Remember that? Yeah. Then he comes the news from February that after studying the thing, we are adding a new layer to Android security, and guys at Google decide to create Google Bouncer as an antivirus for all the applications that the developers put in the marketplace. So basically, this has been the attacking vector, very successful for the attackers. Let's see what happens now with Google Bouncer, if this is going to stop the attackers and they will find out new attacking vectors like they did on PC, because we are here in step zero. I mean, for PCs, it's drive-by downloads, so if you visit any malicious website, you get infected. They are not even using this resource. They are using application marketplace. So in case that marketplace is not able, they will move to these drive-by downloads or exploits in websites. So I think we still have an interesting time to check what's coming next.
So, some words about the SMS Trojans. These are, let's say, the most popular malicious apps among cybercriminals because it's the easiest way to get the money from the user. I think you understand that if you buy a new laptop, you don't have, a direct connection with your money. You just have a laptop. If you buy a smartphone or mobile device, you have a direct connection with your money. You have a SIM card with your mobile account. There is some money, credit card or prepaid SIM card. It doesn't matter. It has your money. So that's why for cybercriminals, sending SMS messages to premium rate numbers is the easiest way to get money from you. And, well, previously, starting from 2006 till 2010, SMS Trojans were mostly a reality for Russian users, for Chinese users. Now we have some kind of migration to the rest of the world. In June 2011, there was the first, really native US premium SMS Trojan. In September, during the autumn, we found more examples of, European SMS Trojans, which targeted users from France, from Belgium, from Switzerland, from Luxembourg, from Spain, from Germany, from United Kingdom, from other countries like Canada, like United States, like Sierra Leone, like Morocco. So from people from many other countries. And these Trojans, they target, all users, because it just simply tried to define where are you from, where is your smartphone from, finds an SMS, a premium SMS number and the SMSX, which is appropriate for your smartphone, and send the SMS message. So we had this migration, and this migration surely will continue in 2012, because we see a growing number of these particular SMS Trojans, which are targeting users from the rest of the world. And now, I would like to pass the word again to Vicente, who is going to talk about Man in the Mobile.
Yeah, this is another interesting attacking vector. You have already seen the basis from Eugene's presentation, but basically it works like this. If you are working with your computer to send some money to your bank account or having some interaction with the web application of your bank account, basically what you need is just your computer. So what happens if your computer gets infected? The bad guys can just send the money to any other bank account. This is a very old technique. We have seen this for years. Nothing new. So what's the solution for this? It's using two-factor authentication. In this case, even if your computer is infected, you will receive an SMS from your bank from a different channel. In this case, it's not the computer, it's the mobile device. In order for send you the MTAN, it's the mobile transaction number, authorization number, sorry, that you need to make this transaction possible. So if even if you have control of the computer, you don't have control of the mobile device, of course, you will be safe. So what happened next? You could imagine, it's very easy. What the bad guys did is they infected the mobile device. In this case, this SMS is not arriving to the final user because it's transparently sent to the bad guy who now has control of both devices, the computer and the mobile. He has the SMS, he has the mobile transaction authorization number, so he could make the transaction to any bank account that he wished. In this case, you see the mobile device is not being infected just per se, but as a complement for the infections on the PCs and circumventing two-factor authentication. That happened for the first time almost 2 years ago, I would say.
In September 2010.
Yeah, that's right. Since then, it's becoming something common and it's affecting now all kinds of operating systems for mobile devices. Initially it was only for Symbian, but now it's...
Symbian, then was BlackBerry, then was Windows Mobile, and finally, well, it was a bit of a surprise to see that cyber criminals, they don't attack Android. They attack Symbian, they attack Windows Mobile, they attack BlackBerry. But finally, in July 2011, cyber criminals create a version of this applications for Android.
Yeah, so basically they are just running after the money, and attacking the mobile is a way for getting access to your bank account.
Well, final chapter, one of the final chapter, this presentation is mobile hacktivism. Well, hacktivism was some kind of a trend, general trend in computer security in 2011. We heard a lot about politically motivated attacks of hackers to the infrastructures of governments, police forces. One question to you, does the name Mohamed Bouazizi is familiar to you, to anybody? One hand, I see one hand, two hands. Okay, let's talk about this Trojan called AirSpam, which basically after infecting your device send SMS messages with URLs to random contacts. URLs redirects users to various forums about this guy, Mohamed Bouazizi. Mohamed Bouazizi was a guy from Tunisia who birthed himself in the capital of Tunisia in order to protest against government because there was no work, no money. And after that, Tunisian revolution has started and the Arab Spring in general has started. So it was like a political act. And, well, this Trojan sent the SMS messages about two legal forums where people discuss Mohamed Bouazizi and Arab Spring in general. And if smartphone has a Bahrain ISO code, so smartphone located in Bahrain, malware downloads a report, a PDF report, from Bahrain Independent Commission of Inquiry about human rights in various countries. So, mobile hacktivism now is also a reality. Politically motivated hackers create malicious applications with let's say, make politically motivated things on the smartphones. So, I think these are the main trends of 2011. We were not able to put all other interesting facts into this presentation, so Vicente?
Yes, final remarks from our presentation. The first one will be how to protect your device and then some predictions for this year. So, as a general advice, what I want you to keep in your head is to have common sense And the most important point for me is the last one. Do not assume your mobile is safer than your PC. So this is my message for you guys today. It could be summarized in this simple phrase. The rest I will explain, but keep this in mind. Because usually the problem is that we don't adapt our mindset to different devices. Everybody, when is receiving some malicious on their PC from phishing or something, just to get the message, we are safe. But we do not realize that we could be having some fraud in our mobile devices. If we are getting one call, one SMS, one message through WhatsApp, wherever, we just think, oh, we should be legitimate. Let's open it. So this is the thing. Having the proper mindset for our mobile device. It's a small computer. It's not like something that could not be infected. Apart from that, use common sense. Lock your screen, security software, wherever you have available for your platform. Back up your data in case something bad happens. Use encryption. Beware of what you install. Even if you are installing something from a legitimate marketplace, it could be asking for permissions that it shouldn't be asking for. Keep that in mind when you're installing like Lightbeam and it's asking for internet permission, having access to your data, having access to your contacts, having access to everything. This is not really a good practice. About jailbreaking your device, keep in mind that after that you will be having trouble in trying to maintain it updated, having everything secure, and updating the patches for vulnerabilities and everything. Connecting to untrusted Wi-Fi is the same for your computer. Keep that in mind even if you are using your mobile. And do not skip updates. This is very important. If you are having something like an iPhone, it's easier for you because usually iTunes open apps and looks for updates and everything. In Android, it depends on the manufacturer, it depends on the carrier, but anyway, it's important for you to keep your system up to the latest version. So, about predictions, please.
So, 2012, I think that first of all, there will be no apocalypse, no end of light, so we're happy, we're good. And the main trends of 2012, again, Android is the main target, it still will be the main target simply because it's the most popular operating system. In 2011, we saw a lot of attacks where malware for Android uses various root exploits in order to get full access to operating system. In 2012, we think that we will see first attacks using various vulnerabilities to infect the device. So let's say we will see first drive-by download attacks. So you won't notice how your device was infected. Malware in official markets and beyond, well, still, we're pretty sure that we'll see more incidents, more bigger incidents in the official markets, not only Android market. First massive was worms for Android. Well, in 2010, 2011, we haven't seen any massive worms attacks, worms spreading on various devices, if we talk about Android. In 2012, we think that's going to happen. Well, from Eugene's presentation, I think you understood that we have a organized mobile crime, finally. And, well, in 2012, the whole, let's say, mobile malware industry will be as a fact, as a thing we should deal with. And finally, mobile espionage, not only like on various, let's say, wives or husbands or children, but also on governments, on various organizations, so let's say commercial espionage is going to be a reality too. And, well, thank you for your attention, thank you, and if you have any questions, I think we have some time.